Good to see you all. Wave, say amen, clap or something. Thank you. And in case you're unable to see or hear, I'm also a black gay guy. I work in television. Specifically, I'm a writer for a TV show called Empire. However, before I wrote a single cookie slap, one of the ways, and we really do write them into the script. She backhands Lucius with the ring on. We're good. However, before I launched my career by making web content. So some of you were in it. Hi, Imani. It was good. I was inspired by AZ Dungey. Where is she? Somewhere over here. Hi. She did it. I was like, if AZ did it, so can I. It'll be fun. I made a web series called Try This Instead, which is about simple ways not to piss off your black friends. So easy stuff. Don't touch my hair. You know, basics. Don't shoot us. Just really normal, basic things. And I made another, more serious documentary short called You're Cute for a Black Guy. A provocative title, yes, but something that I had heard so many times that I could almost tell when it was about to fall from someone's lips. Now, all of these things, as well as, you know, my first job as a writer, conspired to get me repped at CAA. I was so excited, and not just because it was the only agency that my dad had ever heard of. Law school, I mean, come on now. So at one of their mixers, where they were introducing their new blacks to their many producers, I met a pretty high-profile black producer who was working in Hollywood for decades. And when I told him about my documentary, he was fascinated. Not because it was something he'd experienced himself, but because he thought, and I quote, gay guys aren't racist. Sis, what? I asked for clarification. Do you mean that, like, gay guys aren't currently burning a cross on your lawn? No, he explained. He thought that we were just past all that. I'm sorry, where the hell did he get that idea? Do they cleanse you of societal racism at your first Lady Gaga concert? Like, right as Edge of Glory comes on, they're like, fuck it, I'm woke now. Well, he got it from his white friends, with black boyfriends, and he got it from TV. Now, I learned what gay men are from a wonderful website called SeanCody.com. Don't Google it. At least not in public. But for many people, and frankly for me as well, my first experiences with gay people were on TV. I watched Queer as Folk, where four gay friends searched for love and loss in the coolest version of Pittsburgh to never exist. Through them, I learned the following. One, that gay men go dancing. We do something called poppers. And this is very important, tops drive Jeep Wranglers. I learned that living with HIV is not a death sentence, and that it's possible to have a family and find love. On Sex and the City, I learned that gay men go out after 11. And that the job of the gay best friend is to present fashion advice and counsel in the quippiest way possible, preferably over drinks or at a farmer's market. But what I learned most from watching television is that gay stories were white. These shows featured exclusively white casts with exclusively white leads and love interests. And since I didn't get Logo and couldn't watch Noah's Ark, shout out to Patrick, this is what I thought the world to be. And if you did see black gay men on these shows, they fell into two categories. They were either fetishized sexual accessories, or if they were lucky, they got to be someone's black boyfriend, TM. Now, what does it mean to be someone's black boyfriend, TM? Yeah, thank you for getting the TM, it's important. I did trademark it. It's good, it's a brand now. First, you have to get the look. You're gonna need a tight sweater, a devastating body to go underneath that tight sweater. You also need a professional job, attorney, architect, maybe a chef, maybe a cop, right? If we even get to know that much about you. You should be raceless in that you don't talk about being black a lot, but not unaware of your race. And you should be comfortable with at least one joke about the size of your dick. Examples include Tay Diggs on Will and Grace, Blair Underwood, though he was playing straight on Sex and the City, and time-honored favorite, Keith from 6 feet under. Mm-hmm. Sweaters, sweatsuits, and respectability. Now, what's the problem here, Cameron? That sounds like fine, respectable representation. That's all right. What's wrong with any of this? Well, it's a little more complicated than just being featured. It's about how that featuring takes place. So there are only about 300, give or take, active Black writers in the Writers Guild of America, which is the Union of Working Writers, which means that we make up less than 2% of working writers in media, and that our stories are often not being told. But when they are told, they're told through a lens of whiteness. Many white writers use having a Black partner to mean a character is interesting. It's like having a peg leg or a kinky haircut. It's a shorthand for this character is an understanding liberal who is socially aware, when that character needn't demonstrate that awareness anywhere else in their lives. Now, this was used most infamously by Quentin Tarantino in Pulp Fiction, when 2 seconds of having a Black nurse for a wife bought him the right to say the N-word with a hard R no fewer than 6 times. And what's more, it tells the audience that if you have a Black boyfriend, then you'll be all of those things too. And when white people see enough of that on TV, they start to believe that it's true. For instance, I once had a lovely blonde-haired, blue-eyed white man earnestly tell me that he had a better understanding of racism than I ever would because he'd slept with lots of Black men. It suggests that the cure for racism isn't for white people to confront their own prejudices, stop electing politicians who pursue racist policies, or just talk to your Aunt Susie who voted for Trump, but for rather for you to stand in the middle of the Howard campus, turn on Jacked, and grab the first DeAndre you can find. And marry him. Yes, we can. But black people are not racist and penicillin. And being in a romantic relationship with one will not cure you of the systemic prejudices in which you've been steeped. Similarly for Black audiences, it says something even more insidious. It says that as Black men, we should aspire to love white men. The men we see playing these Black boyfriends are always hot and respectable and successful. I would love to have Keith's chest and biceps. But like I said, but the first time I ever saw two Black men fall in love was 2 characters on The Wire. They got to have sex twice in secret before one of them got really violently killed. Which one seems more fun? Which one seems like something you should aspire to? The story tells that if you want to be hot and respectable and successful, then you should get a white boyfriend of your own. Now, last year on Empire, I was fortunate enough to get the opportunity to tell a love story between 2 Black gay men, one who was HIV positive and one who wasn't. We took them all the way from courtship to their wedding and got to stage the first wedding between 2 Black gay men to ever air on network television. Loved that story. They cried tears of joy for those characters. They learned from their experience of being in a surrogacy cordon relationship, and I couldn't help but wonder, to quote, what my early gay life as a Black boy growing up in white schools and all white neighborhoods that told me that I was markedly undesirable would have been like had I been able to bear witness to a couple like Jamal and Kai. Who would I have wanted to love? Who would I have thought was beautiful? What would I have wanted to be? But more than that, love in fiction is a humanizing force. It is the only thing that all people, regardless of race or class or appearance or ability, are capable of experiencing. It's part of what makes us human, and it is one of the only experiences that is universally human. And yet, we live in a world in which we are told that Black men are subhuman. A 12-year-old Black boy with a BB gun is a threat, and he needs to be murdered by the police. A boy with Skittles and a sweatshirt deserves to be shot to death for walking through the wrong place at the wrong time, even if that wrong place is his home. And a young man listening to loud rap music at the gas station deserves to be shot before his killer goes home to eat a pizza with his girlfriend. You can only treat a person with that level of callous disregard if you think they are fundamentally different than you, and that they don't think or feel the same things that you do. That's why I loved Moonlight. because we got to see two big drug dealing ass black men be with black men and feel. We saw them be intimate, fall in love, hurt, and grow. All things that white people get to do on TV every night, but black men are rarely given the opportunity to. Anytime we can show the world black men experiencing universal emotions, we're reaching people who on some level didn't think we had them. So I would challenge my fellow writers and producers and executives to use our voices to let black characters live black lives. And when only 4.6% of black people marry outside their race, that means it's okay to give a black lead a black love. So instead of using black gay men to make your white characters more interesting, use them to explore the full humanity of blackness. Because you never know who's watching. And that's what I got.